So in this module, so far we have talked about how to apply the work energy principle for a singular particle. Now let's see how we can apply this principle for a system of particles. So a system of particles is basically a system where we have, you know, multiple particles, right? What I'm going to do is I'm going to just focus on two particles in here, let's say P1 and P2, okay? And what we want to know is what that work energy formula would be for, let's say, two particles in the system, okay? So the forces acting on the two particles, let's say all the external forces on particle P1 are F1, all the external forces on P2 are F2, and then of course you also have internal forces. So forces on P1 are F1, okay, and those are all the external forces, plus F12. Since this is a two particle system, so we only have force, internal force F12 on P1 from P2. So this is internal. Forces on P2 are F2, which is an external force, plus F21, which is the internal force, on 2 from 1, right? Okay. Now you will recall from our discussion in previous module, which was about kinetics of particles, when we apply Newton's second law to a system of particles, internal forces essentially cancelled out, so they didn't really matter for a system of particles, okay? Now the question over here is, if we apply the work energy principle to these two particles, will the internal forces play any role in determining the work done or not? Okay, so that's what we're trying to answer over here. So particle P1 could be moving along some path, particle P2 could be moving along some path, and remember the two particles could be constrained with respect to each other in some way, or maybe not constrained at all. Okay, so they could be moving completely independently. So P1 is moving along some path, P2 is moving along some path, right? So now let's look at the total work done on the particle 1. So that's integral dW1, so that's integral F1 plus F12 dot is differential displacement. So, you know, differential displacement is, let's say, dr1 for P1, and for P2 it is dr2, right? The work done on 2 is written similarly as integral F2 plus F21 dot dr2. Okay, so those are the work done. Now let's add them together. What do we get? We get integral F1 dot dr1 plus integral F2 dot dr2. So I'm going to write the work done due to external forces first. So this is work done due to external forces, and then we have the work done due to internal forces. Okay, now we know that F12 and F21 are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction, right? So the question is, are these two going to cancel out as a result of that? Well, let's write it down. So I'm going to write this whole thing over here as W external, because I don't want to write this whole expression again. And here I have now integral F12 dot dr1 minus dr2. So I've substituted F21 equal to minus F12 here. Okay, so now let's look at this expression. This is what we need to pay attention to. Is this quantity zero? Well, not in general, because dr1 minus dr2 may not necessarily be zero, right? So what this is saying is that differential displacement of particle P1 and differential displacement of particle P2 could be different with respect to each other, and that means that this quantity would not be zero. Now, of course, this quantity would be zero if, let's say, F12 was zero, if there were no internal forces, but then that would be the trivial case. Or if dr1 and dr2 were same, which would say that the relative displacement between the two particles is zero, or that this force, the internal force, is perpendicular to this vector, right? What is this vector? So this vector dr1 minus dr2 is the difference between these two. Yes? Okay, and it is not necessarily guaranteed that this internal force will be perpendicular to the difference of those two vectors, right? So only scenario when this would really not matter is, I would say, when this relative displacement is zero, okay? And that is not necessarily going to be true, which means that the work done due to internal forces actually will not cancel out. So let me write that down because it's important. So work done due to internal forces in general may not cancel out. Okay, so let's look at an example. So let's say I have a particle A and I have another particle B, and both of these are tied via a, let's say, a inextensible string. All right, okay, and B is being pushed with the force F sub B in this direction. The question is, what is the work done on the system that is shown over here? So the system here is particle A and B together, right? So on both the particles A and B, we have to show all the forces. So we'll have force FB, that's B, normal reaction, the weight on A, the normal reaction, the weight. And then we have the force of tension due to the cable, right? So even though this is a system of particles, we are not going to be drawing the free body diagram of the system. We are always going to be showing the free body diagram individually of the particles, because if we draw the free body diagram of the system, then actually we wouldn't be showing these internal forces. But internal forces actually may give rise to a non-zero work. And if we don't show them, then there is no way we'll be able to compute that. Okay, so, you know, this is slightly different from what we have seen before, where we could choose a system where we could have more than one particle and we wouldn't show the internal forces. But for the from the point of view of applying work energy principle to a system of particles, it's important to draw free body diagram of individual particles. Okay, so let's say, you know, this whole thing is displaced by an amount S. Okay, now because cable between A and B is inextensible, that means A is also going to be moving in this direction by distance S, right? So the work done on A is equal to T times S, and of course NA and MG will do no work, and on B is equal to FB times S minus T times S. Why this is minus? Because T is pointing in the direction opposite of displacement, right? Okay, so in this case, if you add them together, you can see that these two will cancel out, right? And the total work done would be simply FB times S. So in this case, it turns out that the internal forces, the work done by the internal forces actually was zero, right? Because the relative displacement between A and B was zero, right? Now, how would things change if, let's say, I were to replace this cable with a spring? Okay, with a spring of this sort. All right. Now, if I have a spring between the two, I could move this with the force FB. All right, and I know this is going to move by distance S. Does that mean that this particle A is also going to be moving by distance S? Not necessarily, because now the cable is gone. It is not an inextensible cable anymore, which means that the particle A and B could have different displacement, right? So over here, these two cancel out because S was same. But now over here, I could have S1 and S2 over here, and that would mean that these two will not necessarily be same in magnitude, right? So what this is showing you is that in general, when you want to compute the work done on a system of particles, you do have to worry about the work done by internal forces. So far we've just talked about the work done by the forces on a system of particles. Now what happens to the right hand side? So on the right hand side, in the work energy equation for a singular particle, we have the change in kinetic energy, right? So what is the change in kinetic energy for system? Okay, so this would be T2 of the system, or T final minus T initial of the system. So the definition of the kinetic energy is actually not changing. So that is half mv squared, right? For one particle, it is half 1 mv squared, right? For particle 2, it would be 1 half mv2 squared, okay? So this is T1, this is T2, 1 half mv2 squared. And the total kinetic energy of the system is defined as sum of them. So T1 plus T2, okay? So in general, we can write this as sigma 1 half mi times vi squared. Okay, that's how we will write the total kinetic energy of the system. So essentially what you do is you take the kinetic energy of individual particles and you add them together, and that's the kinetic energy of the system. So for a system of particle, we can write work done of the system is equal to change in kinetic energy of the system. That's it. So it's the same equation, except that now you'll be computing the work done of the internal forces as well, and then seeing if they will cancel out or not. Okay, and the right hand side will be change in kinetic energy of the whole system, where the kinetic energy of the system is basically sum of the kinetic energy of individual particles in the system.